The Churches of Christ present Speaking the Truth in Love, a program bringing you life's answers from the Word of God.
Welcome to our program. This program is brought to you by the Churches of Christ in the KAIT TV viewing area. A list of those churches will be scrolled across the screen at the end of the program. Each of these congregations extends to you a warm welcome and invites you to come, visit, and study with them about the great salvation that Jesus Christ made available to all of us. If you have any questions about your salvation or any other Bible subject, feel free to contact any of the Churches of Christ that are in your area. My name is Michael Forche, and I have the privilege of working with the Lord's Church at the Pike Road Congregation in Pantego, North Carolina. Our lesson this morning is entitled, God Has No Grandchildren. One of the reasons why I started looking at this topic of grandchildren is back in October, my wife and myself are blessed to have our first grandchild. So as we started getting used to being called grandparents, I started looking at the Bible, and as I did, I ran across the passage that we're going to be reading, and it's found in Zechariah chapter 8. If you'd like to turn there, as we will read through this passage together, this will begin our lesson, Zechariah 8, verses 4 and 5. Thus says the Lord of hosts, old men and old women shall again sit in the streets of Jerusalem, each one with his staff in his hand because of great age. The streets of the city shall be full of boys and girls playing in its streets. It creates for us a great image. We see that there are two generations represented here. We have the older, more mature, and aged. And due to age, we see that their abilities to move about and their mobility is decreased, as it speaks about them having staff in hand, or as we would think of it, a cane. We then see the opposite image where we look at the streets being full of boys and girls as they are playing in the streets. As we talk about this subject, again, we're going to be looking at and emphasizing this title of God Has No Grandchildren. As I look this over, I wanted to make sure to keep us informed and to remind us that even though we are using this title and talking about grandchildren, I in no way want to leave you with the impression that somehow God does not like little children or that Jesus does not like little children. Actually, in Luke chapter 18 and verse 16, if you recall that passage, there's also a parallel passage in the book of Matthew. But as Jesus was there, the children were coming to him, and you remember the disciples, not sure of all of their intentions there, but looking at the busy schedule of Jesus, what was going on, you remember that they were forbidding the children to come to Jesus. And he speaks to them, and we're reminded of that great phrase as he says, let the little children come to me. So we understand that God is very much in love with children as he has created all of us and desires for children to come to him, as we see that echoed in Jesus as he's speaking there in Luke 18. When we talk about family, there are several passages, and we could probably stand here throughout the program and just read through these verses found in both the book of Psalms and Proverbs. In Psalm 127, verses 4 and 5, the psalmist speaks about that of the blessing of children and uses this phrase. He speaks about the man who is happy that has his quiver full of them, comparing that of children to arrows. So we see abundance and blessing. We also see in Proverbs 17 that the reference is made not only to children, but also to your children's children. That would be how we understand the term grandchildren. So as we are looking at this, I want to take you through a few things so that we can figure out why it is that we're going to talk about that God has no grandchildren. First and foremost, I'd like to remind all of us that when it comes to a congregation, that we're looking at things such as growth. And many times in our prayers, we word that we would grow not only spiritually, but also numerically. These are two primary ways that we look at growth. Spiritually, we're talking about our own spiritual maturity, and growth, of course, we're looking more at expansion or the numbers. As we talk about what our responsibilities are from one generation to the next, again, if you have your Bibles with you, you can turn to the book of Deuteronomy, and we'll look at chapter 4. And as we're looking at chapter 4, we'll move down in the chapter to verse 9 as we're looking at what we should leave for the next generation. Deuteronomy 4 and verse 9 reminds us, as God speaks to his people, "Only take heed to yourself and diligently keep yourself, lest you forget the things your eyes have seen, unless they depart from your heart all the days of your life, and teach them to your children and your grandchildren." So we see we have a responsibility, not only looking at our own personal growth or the growth within a congregation, but we have a responsibility to the next generation. Now, I ran across some interesting information, was doing some studies and some research and looking at the mission fields. And some of the things I want to share with you today are taking in account that of the growth patterns. And perhaps if you've celebrated as many birthdays, perhaps as I have, or more, you have noticed some things, kind of changes, growth patterns, things like that that are taking place perhaps where you worship. And it was interesting to look at this and going back, and this examines four different generations within a congregation. The first generation, as was described, are in a sense, as they were described by the author of the material, as the founding fathers. They joined together in an intense and purposeful partnership at very difficult times. They paid a high price. They risked such things as their reputations, their investments, and even their lives to bring about a congregation of the Lord's people in their local area. The second generation, now they may have experienced some of the same problems as those who were the founders, but by and large, they had only a second-hand commitment and a vision of the cause. Now what we notice as we move from first generation, second, now we're up to third. With the third generation, we're looking at the same area, the same building, if you would. The third generation loses vision, having known only the life of the institution. They are members in name only, and not sure why the institution exists, and have really minimal interest in keeping it going. By the fourth generation, as the author explains, traditions and habits are the only thing that keep the doors open, and ultimately the congregation dies of boredom and division. Now this is not what, of course, all of us are looking at doing or looking forward to, but there is a reality, and that brings about our lesson today, that God has no grandchildren. What we want to do with this is we're going to add to that title. As we've been saying and have mentioned many times that God has no grandchildren, I want to remind you that as God has no grandchildren, he only has children. And what we are looking at, I've looked at this topic, researched it, I've preached on it many different ways. And the original way that I looked at this, this was kind of the phrase I used, coattail righteousness. And I'm sure you've all run across this, maybe in your homes, maybe in your works, where it seems that as we talked about, the first generation starting a congregation, putting in the labor, the time, the hours, the sweat and tears, we can add. Then what we look at is that others merely ride on their coattails. And we're going to bring this up because what I've found, and if you're following along in your Bible, if you go over to the book of Ezekiel, in chapter 14, in verse 14, Ezekiel is trying to reason with his generation. And just a little bit of background so you know what we're getting into context-wise. Ezekiel is part of the generation that was taken in the Babylonian captivity. Now with this, one of the things that, or problems that Ezekiel encountered is that the generation didn't seem to believe that they were being punished and they were taken from their homeland, even though as they opened their eyes and looked around, everything looked different. So Ezekiel is trying to reason with them. This is God's punishment. We're going to be here. You might as well get comfortable, as we would say in our terms. But the people have not yet accepted it. Even though they recognize that they're not in their homeland, they're saying, oh, we'll just be here a short time. So in Ezekiel 14, in verse 14, he brings up three names of very noteworthy Bible characters, and he's reminding the group, the audience that's before him, that even if, and catch these names, Noah, Daniel, or Job were here, God is not going to change his mind. Ezekiel points out they could save their own selves, meaning that with their faith and their obedience to God, but it wasn't going to spare the nation, even if we have great men such as Noah, Daniel, and Job. And we're also reminded of this, I found this very interesting. Not only does Ezekiel speak about this, using names of great Bible characters, and again, we're talking about the responsibility we have and accountability of each one of us, that we cannot spiritually ride the coattails of someone else. We've mentioned Ezekiel 14 and verse 14, but then we move forward and we notice in Jeremiah chapter 15 and verse 1, so add these names to your list. Ezekiel said, even if Noah, Daniel, or Job were here, their righteousness wouldn't save you. They would stand before God for their faith and their obedience, but just because they're near you, it's not going to do anything for you. But then Jeremiah adds these names, Moses and Samuel. So look at this. This list of names that Ezekiel and Jeremiah have mentioned, Noah, Daniel, Job, then Moses, and Samuel. And the prophets are reminding God's people that we have to become accountable and we have to understand what we are doing. It wouldn't matter if, say, your grandparents were good, faithful Christians. I mean, it matters to God and it matters to the example, but as far as your own soul, that's why we've selected this title of God Has No Grandchildren. God is looking for children. Each one of us as believers, baptized believers, as we've been baptized for the remission of sins into that of the body of Christ, the church, we are all first generation. This means we have a personal relationship with our God. It's not, and I was trying to think of this, I'm sure you've heard that phrase, you know, I know a guy, you know, it's one of those that it's not I can do it, or it's not something I've said or that I am doing at this current time, but I know someone. And that's what Ezekiel and Jeremiah are trying to clear up. That it wouldn't matter if Noah, Daniel, and Job were there, or Moses and Samuel, as Jeremiah adds, the congregation and ourselves, we need to be children of God. A relationship that we have personally with God, it is not because of who our parents are or our grandparents or, as we would say, so on and so forth with the generations. So in looking at this problem, I was reading through the book of Psalms, and I'm going to encourage you that if you have a Bible that is available to you, to go ahead and open it up to Psalm 144. I found some great verses in here that will help us out. I'm sure that all of us, if we can dig into God's Word and get some encouragement, as we're either trying to raise children or raise grandchildren, any help is always appreciated. But we're going to look at Psalm 144. And as we understand from the title, it's attributed to that of David. And we're going to find, and we're going to give you a quick outline, 3 points. As many of you that are familiar with preachers, we like to do a 3-point outline. It's easy for us to remember and easy for you to remember. But let's notice these 3 points. Within Psalm 144, and again, we're looking at, and our problem that we're trying to deal with, God is not looking for grandchildren, but God is looking for children. Each one of us has a responsibility to have a personal relationship with our God. It is not through past generations or others, but our own relationship. So in order to look at this problem, we're going to notice what David does. Here's the 3 points that we spoke about in Psalm 144. He will begin in verses 1 through 4, and he will speak about and praise God for past victories. David then, in the next section, verses 5 through 11, he's going to petition God for his present problems, or he's looking for present deliverance. And then in the remainder of the psalm, verses 12 through 15, we're going to notice that in this section, David is going to present for us a picture of future blessings. Now, as I had reminded you, if you have your Bible, you can leave it open to Psalm 144, and we'll read through these verses, and we'll see what it was that David was looking at as he talks about what God has done for him and praises him for the past victory, as he's looking at his current situation and his petition for a present deliverance. But then we're going to notice that final section where he is going to have with him a picture of future blessings. So as we begin in the psalm, verses 1 through 4, notice how David begins as he praises God. Blessed be the Lord my rock, who trains my hands for war and my fingers for battle. My loving kindness and my fortress, my high tower and my deliverer, my shield and the one in whom I take refuge, who subdues my people under me. Lord, what is man that you take knowledge of him, or the son of man that you are mindful of him? Man is like a breath, his days are like a passing shadow. David begins with that of praise of God, looking at what God has done for him, looking at, David is making reference, we believe, to his own leadership as a king, that God has subdued the people under him. But then there's a nice transition between verses 2 and 3. David begins praising God, exalting God, but then David looks around and he says, Lord, what is man that you take knowledge of him? David realizes God's exalted position and realizes himself as a man and all the rest of us as well as mankind, where we fit in. And asking the question, God, why do you even take notice of us? So he's praising God in those first 4 verses. The next, David is dealing with some difficulty. It's not exactly spelled out for us. But verses 5 through 11, he calls on God for deliverance for this present problem. Bow down your heavens, O Lord, and come down, touch the mountains, and they shall smoke. Flash forth lightning and scatter them. Shoot out your arrows and destroy them. Stretch out your hand from above. Rescue me and deliver me out of great waters from the hand of foreigners, whose mouth speaks lying words and whose right hand is a right hand of falsehood. I will sing a new song to you, O God, on a harp of 10 strings. I will praise you, the one who gives salvation to kings, who delivers David his servant from the deadly sword. Rescue me and deliver me from the hand of foreigners whose mouths speak lying words and whose right hand is a right hand of falsehood. Again, we are not exactly sure, just meaning that it's not told to us in these verses, of what problem David was dealing with, but we see that he is petitioning God. He has already praised God for the things God has done. David has a great trust in our God and is looking for and petitioning God to help me again. And as we are noticing these things, he's talking about, and we use the word in the references, foreigners, lying words, falsehood, and David is calling upon God to again intervene and to help. And of course, David as king, we may be able to link this together, that not only David in his position as a king is looking for help, but for the nation of Israel as well. But here is why I selected Psalm 144. When we pick up in verse 12, and I want you to think about this, David as the leader, as the king of United Israel at this time, he is looking around. He has praised God. He recognizes what God has done for him. He recognizes who God is. He has a personal relationship with God. He recognizes now he's in difficulty and he's having problems, again, turning to God, asking God to help him with these difficulties. So picture this. We have a leader. We have a problem in a nation. And we're now going to notice in verse 12 of where David turns to help his nation. In our mindsets, if we were thinking about foreigners, as David uses the term, if we were thinking about someone, you know, attacking our nation or doing something, perhaps our thoughts would be different. And that's why I enjoy what David has to say in verse 12. You know, think of yourself as a king or a leader of a nation, and you're having difficulties within the nation, wouldn't it be easier if he turned to God and said, give me more chariots, give me more weapons, give me more strength so I can go out and defeat my enemies? And there could be things such as asking for more wealth or more money. And regardless of what nation we live in, every single nation has their own problems. But we're going to notice in verse 12, as we are emphasizing that not only ourselves, but our children, grandchildren, and generations to come need to work towards that relationship with God of being his child and not his grandchild. In verse 12, this is what David has to say to us. Remember, the nation's in trouble, there's problems. And he begins in verse 12, and he says, that our sons may be as plants grown up in their youth, that our daughters may be as pillars sculptured in palace style, that our barns may be full, supplying all kinds of produce, that our sheep may bring forth thousands and 10,000s in our fields, that our oxen may be well laden, that there be no breaking in or going out, that there be no outcry in the streets. Happy are the people who are in such a state. Happy are the people whose God is the Lord. In verses 12 through 15, it's really interesting to me, and that's why I wanted to share it with you. David looking at the nation's suffering, there's national problems, and I appreciate what David does in verse 12, because he doesn't turn to military might, he doesn't turn to we need more wealth or we need this or that, but he looks directly into his own home. And he starts with the young people. He starts with, as he mentioned, sons and daughters. And some of the things that are interesting that he brings out there in verse 12 is he's talking about the sons, that they are going to grow up as plants or as trees, recognized for their strength. We know that, yes, sometimes plants grow up by accident, but he's looking at, let's plant them. This means we are providing them with an outline for life. Here is what's important. And David is saying, my nation's suffering, and we're going to start in the home. And he says, let our sons be like strong trees that grow up in their youth. Also, David's not saying we're going to wait till they get older and then we're going to start teaching them, but let them grow up strong in their youth. He then turns from the topic of sons and moves to that of daughters. Now with this, one of the things that I had to make sure when I was studying through this, if you just read through verse 12 real quick, we kind of have a stereotypical description. Let the men be strong and let the women be pretty. But I don't believe that's what David is doing. He's talking about the young men being planted. He is talking about the young women then. If you put together these verses, it shows that they would be sculpted or carved again in their place in the king's palace. So this is not an accident. This is not something that David is just really saying, oh, let the young men be strong, let the young women be pretty. But he's saying to parents, here's what our nation needs. As David speaks as the king, we need to begin with our young people, and we need to bring them up as we recognize Paul writing in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. We see, and I'll give you these points to add to your study this morning, we see the priority of it. That David is saying it's not something that we lead this up to, well, we hope they turn out okay, but a priority. Plant them, sculpt them. Also, we need a plan. It's not something that we just kind of haphazardly look at. David's saying, here's what our nation needs. Let's start in the home and build up our young people. Also, the place. Do you all remember, perhaps in your childhoods, walking back and forth for the store or home or to school, and there was that big tree you always remembered? You took shade under its branches. You appreciated it as it was, that big, strong tree. So there's a placement of both the boys and the girls, the sons and the daughters. And there's a purpose. And the purpose that we bring out is, of course, to be pleasing to God. And also we see, as we think about this, the partnership. When it comes to, as we've been drawing this comparison, God having children, and as we said, God has no grandchildren, only children, we're looking at a partnership between the home and family and God, between the home, the church congregation, and God. And we're talking about this partnership, again, we're focusing upon, as David did, in the midst of his nation having difficulties and foreigners and the problems that were brought about, and David brings back, he wants to start in the home. That of reminding our young people of the relationship that they can have with God, and not to try and ride coattails of others, but to know their God and to come to know Him and to enjoy the relationship that they can have with them. So I hope that we have cleared up speaking about God having no grandchildren, reminding us God has children. I thank you for your time.
We have heard the joyful sound. Jesus says, Jesus says, spread the tidings all around.
If you have a Bible question, would like to receive a free Bible correspondence course, would like a copy of 2 free books, Why I'm a Member of the Church of Christ, and basic Bible lessons, please contact the Nettleton Church of Christ. Speaking the Truth in Love can be viewed online. Speaking the Truth in Love is brought to you by these area Churches of Christ.